Hello everybody, Dr. Carlo Oger, board certified emergency physician with DrER.tv. Don't forget, visit that website. I'm working on it constantly. I'm going to make it super awesome with gallery of pictures, my latest post, and everything.
Always. So, on a quick note, is the psych paper that had the level 1, 2, and 3, please don't put that on the chart. We do it digitally now, and when you put it in the chart, it goes on our papers that we never signed because we never had to, and then we have to sign them manually later, so it goes on our delinquency list and things like that. So because it's electronic, we don't have to do it on paper. We shouldn't have it anymore, all right?
Why don't they just throw it away?
Yeah. We should. That's what you should
do. We just need to pull it out of the packet and then throw it away.
Okay. So the other one we're going to talk about in the medical minute is about the use of hypertonic saline in severe traumatic brain injury, or TBIs. Now, these are patients with severe brain injuries, GCS scores of 8 and less. Why would we even give hypertonic saline to a patient with a brain injury? Any ideas? So, patient... hypertonic saline. So, people with severe brain injuries usually have increased intracranial pressure, or ICP. You're trying to bring that pressure in the brain down. The most common way is to decrease the total intravascular volume. The most common drug used for those purposes is mannitol. Mannitol, the disadvantages, and the reason it hasn't proven any benefit in TBI patients is because mannitol is also a diuretic, which can result in later hypotension and worsening traumatic injuries, especially if the patient's bleeding and stuff like that. So hypertonic saline is not a diuretic, so it should have a theoretical benefit compared to mannitol. So they've done many studies related to this, and this one in particular is a systemic review of multiple randomized controlled trials where they do hypertonic saline in patients with brain injuries and increased ICP. So the bottom line is that it did not prove to be of any benefit, and it didn't cause any harm either, so it's really just a very expensive bag of saline. But it's not just the expense. In order to do hypertonic saline, you need to put a central line. So that's morbidity to that patient. Now, if they're severe traumatic brain injury, they probably have a central line anyway. But in healthy young adults with normal kidneys, it's really hard to do what it's meant to do. For example, when my wife had the encephalitis, she had increased brain edema and swelling. And one of the things they proposed was using hypertonic saline through a central line to make the swelling go down. I was in touch via email to other doctors in Alabama who are specialists in encephalitis, and they said if they haven't started yet, tell them not to, kind of refuse the medication. But at that point, she already had the central line, so we decided to go ahead and do it. See, the problem is this. In order to do it well, you need to actually increase the patient's sodium to 150 or something, almost about 142, 143. You have to make it 150 or more. But in a normal patient, to increase it to 150, as soon as the body knows the sodium is high, it starts peeing a lot. So it's really hard to keep chasing it. You got to keep checking sodiums almost every 2 hours to try to chase and try to get to that level where the blood is actually hypertonic with saline, and it results in actual effect. So bottom line is it really didn't work for her. She ended up pulling her line, and nobody ever really chased the sodium. So what's the point of even doing it? In this particular patient, they did a randomized control trial. It didn't work. So as we move hopefully to a level 2 trauma center, level 3 initially, is that they might still want to do this. Their trauma doctors were trained. They've done it before. But the literature shows no improved benefit from it. That's it.
Thank you.